Hi. Have you noticed that knowledge is almost forgotten? Even if it has been the base for human progress for many, many generations. Have we come to a stage where hidden interests, feelings should steer our choices? Because knowledge is huge, it's complex. We store it into computers. And from there, perhaps use it when needed. Just go to your own working place. How important is knowledge in your decision making? And how much do other factors influence what you do? For those of you that might have forgotten the use of knowledge, I would then like, as introduced, to give you an illustrative dancing lesson to show you what it is all about. So this is, just follow now. You use the existing knowledge in your back, and that will push you forward. And then, almost immediately, you challenge that existing knowledge to go perhaps a little bit further, in a slightly different direction, and thereby give progress a possibility. That's it. Did you get it? Good. So I now go back in this dance to medicine, which is my field, to show you how existing knowledge is used today. Aortic aneurysms is a widening of the biggest vessel we have in our body. It can be like a balloon here in the abdomen, and it can suddenly just rupture. And if so, you can die. But there is solid global knowledge saying that this disease should be operated upon at a diameter of 55 millimeters, because then the risk with the disease is higher than the risk with the operation. If you operate upon it at a smaller size, the risk with the operation is higher, and then you shouldn't do it. You got it? In a recent publication from Schanzer, covering more than 10,000 patients in the United States, 59% were operated upon at a size lower than 55 millimeters. And not only that, over 30% of the patients had to face a technique that was outside the instructions for use for the device implanted. Why? What is steering us? Another example, tonsillectomy, that is to remove the tonsils from the throat. It has a knowledge-based indication, but the variation in frequency between our Nordic countries is over 370%. And that is even reflected here in Norway, just to the south of us. We have a county called Møre and Romsdal. There are certainly people from there here. And that's divided into 26 minor municipalities. And the variation is 480%. That is to say, almost a five-fold difference in this operation. Again, why? And the thing is that we can pick any type of disease in any type of geography, and you will see a similar situation. So in summary, if we do not apply the existing knowledge, some patients, they will not get the operation they need. Others, they will actually be operated upon unnecessary, and sometimes even with techniques outside written and tested instructions. Surprised, hey? Now for the next little step. That's the advanced one, the sidestep. The challenging of the existing. That is to say that knowledge is alive. It is continuously changing. That is to say that me and you, we, are the only ones that can change knowledge. The computer here thereby does not have the ability to cover all aspects of knowledge. It has to be with us, used by us, and challenged by us. So, may I ask you a small question? Are you welcome to challenge the environment where you are, where you work? Are you allowed to ask the question why? And if so, if you do that, will you then be regarded as a representative of progress or a troublemaker? My task here is not to challenge you. It is, from an academic standpoint, always better to challenge yourself. So I would then like to challenge the existing knowledge in medicine. Is that necessary as part of this dance? In 1949, Antonio Moniz got the Nobel Prize for an operation, lobotomy. And that is a neurosurgery where you cut off the nerves to the frontal lobe. It was good against psychosis, but it left behind emotionally blunt people, reduced intellectual capacity, and mental invalids. I want you to think, would it have been possible to save some people from this operation if we had been able to challenge the existing knowledge? 2,500 people were operated here in Norway until 1957. So would that have been good for these individuals? Then some of you would say, there are a lot of young people here. You would say, well, that was 60 years ago. I don't care. But do you know, if you look at the causes of death, what is on the third place? After cardiovascular disease and cancer. It is actually the use, or I would say rather, the misuse of medicine. So even today, in my field, and you could consider your fields, it is necessary to challenge the existing. And how can we create an atmosphere where that is allowed? We have to welcome diversity, because it's only in discussions with people having different opinions that knowledge can propel, get on further. And these individuals must have the ability to make a difference between subject and person. So I stand here for a call for the ongoing development of knowledge to be applied in all fields of humanity. I urge you to learn these two steps of dancing. I urge you to apply the question why, and let the hidden interests, the feelings, little bit be reduced in decision making. Because if you follow my recipe, you will bring mankind, societies, fields like medicine back to a prosperous, knowledge-based future. Let's go for a why revolution.